Terry, okay.
Hello.
Hello, Terry. Now we have the last sessions. We have a very long day yesterday, and today we have the imaging session, and now coming to the structural heart disease. I think that the Paris-Sud is very famous for structural heart disease, one of the pioneer centers. So I have with me Professor Mohammad Sada, the co-chairman, and Dr. Ahmed Yahya, Dr. Mohammed Zahran, Dr. Tamer Mustafa, Dr. Waheed Ammar, and Dr. Ahmed Amara, waiting just for Dr. Yasser Sadr. I think you are starting now with the, I remember that we were with you in Paris-Sud, and you have live cases and hand on with TAVI, and you started to say that we are now doing the simplistic TAVI or minimalistic TAVI. So are you going to speak about this first topic, to Terry Lefebvre, TAVI, simplification is the ultimate sophistications?
Yes, thank you very much, Mohammed. So I had the chance to start very early the TAVI procedure in 2004. And of course, we have now done more than 3,000 cases, and we have a lot of experience. Everybody in the cath lab is doing TAVI now in my center, all the interventional cardiologists. So of course, as you know, the first case was done by Alain Cribier in 2002. And the dream of Alain was that this procedure should be done in the cath lab on conscious sedation. It was the case for the first case. This patient had the cardiac shock bicuspid valve. He was relatively young. Surgery was denied because of cardiac shock. And the procedure was done on conscious sedation in the cath lab. We learned from Einstein that everything should be made as simple as possible, but of course it should not be simpler. So the sophistication is to be simple and to simplify the procedure. So of course, at the very beginning, many centers were using general anesthesia, but general anesthesia is associated with hemodynamic instability, late stroke identification, the risk of pulmonary infection because of intubation, prolonged IQ on hospital stay. So in 2009, we decided to move to conscious sedation. So the first cases were done on general anesthesia, but we moved to conscious sedation 12 years ago. And we have very good results with that. And progressively in France, conscious sedation increase, and last year it was more than 85% of cases. We have a lot of data showing that conscious sedation is better than general anesthesia in instability, need for catecholamine, need for transfusion, meta-analysis showing that the death of rate is lower if you use conscious sedation as opposed to general anesthesia, and length of stay is also shorter. Then we understood at the very beginning that we use too much monitoring. So urinary catheter, jugular or subclavian vein, radial artery monitoring, transesophageal echo. So again, in 2009, we moved to transthoracic echo, and that's why we were able to move to conscious sedation. And we removed the urinary catheter, jugular or subclavian vein, and we use since 2009, two venous lines, including one in the basilic vein, if possible, because you can use it for pacemaker if necessary. There is also a discussion about hybrid operating room versus cath lab, and we look at that in the national, in the French National Registry. So you can see the difference. This is a hybrid room that we opened in 2009 in Massy, and this is a procedure in the cath lab with Hakim. So you see that we have only two operators, one nurse outside, and of course the surgeon is available in the center, but not in the cath lab. We look at that, and in fact we understood in the French National Registry that the patients in the cath lab were older, they had a higher logistic euro score, more coronary disease, and lower renal function. So in fact, we were treating people who were more diseased in the cast lab as opposed to hybrid room. And if you look at the result, the only difference, significant difference, was that there were less infection in the cast lab as compared to the hybrid room. Of course, it's opposed to what we were thinking, but it's a reality. Of course, the setup is simplified. So one senior, usually one fellow, one nurse. And of course, we have a second nurse for the crimping. We have the echo available in the cast lab. And I think it's very important to have echo available in the cast lab. We have an anesthetist, of course. It's for conscious sedation. It's very important to have the patient quiet on the table. And of course, we have the echocardiographist immediately available and the cardiac surgeon immediately available if necessary. We learn also a lot about access site complications. So the risk of dissection, occlusion, perforation, rupture of the vessel, hematoma, need for transfusion. And in fact, this decreased progressively with a better pre-procedural screening, the use of ProStar, and more recently, the use of two ProGlides, and the learning of peripheral intervention. So we create very early a toolbox for peripheral intervention. And now echo-guided puncture is used more frequently. So now the majority of operators are using echo-guided puncture for the artery and for the vein. What we learn is that secondary access is associated also with complication. And as you can see, major vascular complication is coming from the opposite way, the femoral way, in 35% of cases. So that's why we decide to move to the radial approach as a secondary access. And we have done that 5 years ago now. And we are very comfortable with this approach. So we use the radial approach as a contralateral approach. And of course, we develop all the necessary tools for doing like that. We have done a study which showed that we were able to reduce the risk of major complication. And the surprise was that we had a lower risk of stroke by using a radial approach as compared to a contralateral femoral approach. At that time, we published this paper, and we were not sure about the reality of this reduction of stroke. But then there was another paper published 2 years later by Junquera, who showed exactly the same. So risk of stroke was divided by two if you use a radial as compared to the femoral approach. And they found also that there were less access site complication, less transfusion, etc. Of course, we develop a peripheral kit, but also a radial kit in order to be able to solve the technical problems or the complication that we may have through the main access, the main femoral access. So we have long wires, we have a balloon with a shaft of 200 centimeters. So we are able to treat problems with that. And we have also covered stent that we can use like the big graft that we can use from the radial access in the majority of cases. We learned very early that predilatation is associated with more complication. So we moved to no predilatation in the majority of cases in 2014. Of course, sometimes you need to predilate when you have very high Euro score. But in the vast majority of cases, we don't use predilatation. A temporary pacemaker is also associated with complications like infection, hematoma, transfusion, the risk of tamponade. So we stopped using left ventricular wire stimulation in 2015, sorry, not 2005, by using the wire for the simulation. So we can use it. It's very simple. You have one needle in the skin of the patient for the anode and one on the stimulator, and then you can stimulate, and it's as reliable and maybe better reliable than the transfemoral approach. We have done a study who showed that, so it was a randomized study, Easy TAVI study published 2 years ago, who showed that the cost was lower, of course, the procedure duration was shortened by 7 minutes, and the risk of complication, which was not significantly different, but you can see the trend in favor of this approach because we have less complication. But of course, the number of patients was not enough to show a significant difference. Acute kidney injury is also a big problem with this kind of patient because they have poor renal function, they are very old. So we start very early to be careful with that, with an optimal patient preparation, with screening separated by the procedure by 1 or 2 weeks, and dilution of contrast by 20% of saline. And of course, we can use the optimal view directly defined by the MSCT. So we don't need to inject in the aorta several times in order to find the best view for to be perpendicular to the annulus. Of course, there is also rare complication like annulus rupture, left ventricular perforation, coronary occlusion, PVL, significant PVL. And I think MSCT is probably the best way to avoid this kind of complication. So look carefully at MSCT to select the optimal valve for each individual patient. Use coronary protection when needed, so you can identify the risk by MSCT2. So in fact, MSCT is really the guarantee, and good analysis is the guarantee to have a low risk of complication. About DAPT, I think you see some recent publication. Of course, it may be associated with access site complication. Very important not to start Plavix and aspirin before the procedure, but after. And of course, it can be associated also with hemorrhagic stroke. So what we do today is to use DAPT for only 1 month after the procedure. If a patient had a recent stent, we move to 3 to 6 months, and sometimes we're able to shorten to only one month. And in the patient who have already anticoagulation, we do not give DAPT. Of course, we add aspirin in case of recent stenting. As you know, the popular study was published last year in the New England Journal of Medicine, and it was very interesting to see that if you look at the bleeding using aspirin and clopidogrel versus aspirin only, the risk of bleeding is lower, clearly. And the difference appears within the first months. Now, if you look at this from cardiovascular cause, ischemic stroke or MI, you can see that there is some excess of bleeding, of complication when you add both. But at 1 year, there is no significant difference. What we learned from the recent registry of TVT registry in the US, I think it's very interesting because you can see that the femoral approach increased progressively and now is used in more than 95% of cases in the US, while the transapical approach was increasing in the early years, decreased progressively, and now it's close to zero. And the direct aortic, which was an alternative, was also used, but it decreased close to zero. So today, because of the evolution of the THV, you can really use a transfemoral approach in the majority of cases. We learned also that hospital stay is decreasing progressively, and now in the US, the hospital stay after TAVI is about 2 days, so very short. In France, we are not as good as in the US, and it's close to 5 days. So why we should make it simple? I think you shorten the procedural time, especially if you are working in the cath lab. You have a better patient comfort, less complication. You decrease intensive care unit and hospital stay. You decrease the staff workload, which is very important for any hospital. You lower the cost, and you may improve the midterm outcomes. So thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you, Terry. Any questions from the panelists? Yes.
Okay, good morning. I want to ask about a patient with bilateral peripheral arterial disease. What's your best approach to DUTAVI?
It depends which kind of peripheral disease you have. So when you do the screening, we always do a selective femoral angiogram from the radial approach in order to identify potential problems. In case of doubt, we do MSCT, and then we decide. But today, you can do many cases through the femoral approach, including patients with some disease of the femoral or iliac arteries. And the shockwave technology can be very useful in this setting. So because you can pre-dilate with shockwave technology, and usually you don't need to put a stent in the majority of cases. So I think that's why the femoral approach is increasing progressively, and today it should be femoral approach should be higher than 90% of cases for sure.
Okay, which type of TAVI need for valve in valve? What is the most approach?
Okay, so it will be discussed in the next lecture, but in summary, it's à la carte. So according to MSCT, you will decide which kind of valve will be the best for the patient, for each patient. And it depends on many parameters which are evaluated by MSCT.
Hello, Terry.
Yes.
This is Mohamed Sadaqa. I would like to thank you for the simple presentation containing valuable knowledge. Actually, my question to you, in high-risk patient with aortic stenosis, who are, of course, not eligible for open heart and aortic valve replacement, and they are candidate for TAVI, if there is any score or any tool you can use to assess the post-procedural recovery of the patient, I mean, if you have a patient with morbid obesity, for example, patient with severe osteoarthritis, limitation of movement, something like that. Do you have any limitation for those kind of patient to not to do TAVI on those patients also because post-procedure there will be a big problem in rehabilitation, or what you are going to do in such patient?
Okay, so it's a complex discussion because usually these patients do not need any rehabilitation. So they are coming from home and they go back to home because it's like a PCI. So it's really a procedure without general anesthesia, which is very well tolerated. And the patient are, there is not a shock like you have when you have aortic valve replacement. So no need for rehabilitation. Of course, there is exceptions. So some patients are very fragile. And if we have a doubt about the capacity of recuperation of the patient, usually we do a valvuloplasty, balloon aortic valvuloplasty, and reassess the patient after 2 or 3 weeks to see if they are improving. And then we do TAVI, and sometimes they may have surgery. Sometimes we see patients coming in cardiac shock. We do balloon valvuloplasty, and after a few weeks, they have fully recovered, and they may be good candidates even for surgery.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Terry, for this excellent presentation. Few short questions. First, you mentioned that the routine is LV pacing, not RV pacing. What if the patient developed some form of conduction defects, spondyl branch or more? Would you insert our RV pacing for?
Yeah, of course. So it's a very good point. Of course, in about 5 to 10% of cases, we may need a pacemaker. For example, if we have a patient with a right bundle branch block, we put a pacemaker because we know that the risk of AV block is higher. At the end of the procedure, if we have a large left bundle branch block, we'll insert also a pacemaker. So more than 140 or 150 milliseconds, we'll put a pacemaker because we know that the risk of AV block within the next 1 or 2 days is high.
You want a temporary pacemaker, temporary.
Temporary pacemaker, yes.
Thank you, doctor. Yeah. Can I ask two small questions, rapid questions? The first one, what about aortic bicuspid valves? Before, we couldn't use the TAVI, but actually, I know that it's going on in practice. What do you think about this? And second question, what about the echo, actually? You are using only transthoracic echo in your laboratory?
Yes. So for the echo, we have the echo in the room, and we do systematically echo at the end of the procedure to check the gradient and to check PVL and the pericardium. So it's the routine in the cath lab, and sometimes we do post dilatation because we may have some PVL or some residual gradient which is too high. Now for the other question, what was the other question?
Bicuspid, yes.
Yeah, so bicuspid, we know that we have good results with bicuspid valve. So we understood that many years ago because without MSCT, we were not identifying all patients with bicuspid valve. And we realized that we have done a lot of patients with bicuspid valve. So the rule is in patients who are not candidate for surgery, we do bicuspid valve. In the patient with intermediate risk, then we have a discussion. So is it a bicuspid valve that we can treat with a good result in the majority of cases or not? If it's the case, we do TAVI. It's not the case, we discuss about surgery. And of course, in a low-risk patient, it's a little bit different because this patient, if the bicuspid is not, the anatomy of the patient with bicuspid is not optimal, then I think it's better to go to surgery. So it's really a la carte, depending on the patient, and we analyze carefully the MSCT several times before the procedure to check that what will be the best approach.
Thank you. Thanks for the excellent presentation. And I want to ask if there is, from your point of view, any subsets of patients need for long-term depth therapy or even anticoagulation?
No, we do not give anticoagulation. So after TAVI, it's à la carte. So the patient on anticoagulation for another reason, and about 25% of patients have AF, for example, so they are on anticoagulation, so we continue the anticoagulation. In the other patients, we give DRPT for a short term, usually 1 to 3 months, according to the bleeding risk. So if they have a patient with a high bleeding risk, we give only aspirin or Plavix. If they are low risk, we give 1 to 3 months of DRPT.
Yes, yeah.
In cases of advanced peripheral arterial disease, I'm wondering why don't you use the left subclavian approach?
Speaking about other routes rather than the femoral. This, I'm extending the questions. Speak about the subclavian, the carotids, the direct aortic approach, the caval approach.
Yeah. So in my center, the majority of cases are done through the femoral approach, so more than 90% of cases. Of course, there is cases which are not, we cannot do through the femoral. And then the transapical was abandoned, transaortic, very, very rare, and the majority are done through the carotid, transcarotid approach.
Don't do the subclavian, the left subclavian.
And the subclavian is very unusual in our center.
How frequent you need the coronary protection and how to do that? Just guiding or another thing?
Yeah, for native aortic valve, it's relatively rare. So it depends really on the patient, which kind of valve we are using. So sometimes we have to start with the protection. So we, if we estimate that there is a risk of coronary occlusion, we protect the left main or the right or both sometimes with a guide and the wire.
Sometimes in some, I just have a live case with the Erasmus, with the Nicholas. He's speaking about also the same discussion about the cerebral protection. I don't find the solution for the, or the answer or the right answer for this problem. Some of the Americans using cerebral protection, some of the German people, some of the Holland, but in France, I didn't find any cerebral protection. So how can we solve it? All the review articles show that there is no significant benefit, but still insisting in using this cerebral protection.
Yeah, I agree, Mohamed, with you. I think we are not enough data to say we should use cerebral protection. So maybe in some specific cases where you have aortic debris in the horizontal aorta, for example, or something like that. In my center, we don't use it at that time. And I really think that we need a strong data, which is not the case today. They are using it in Toulouse, for example, with Didier Cheche and Nicolas Dumonteil. But they are doing a study, so it's a prospective analysis in specific higher risk patients. But in our center, we don't use it because we have the risk of stroke is so low we have very low risk of stroke in our institution.
Yeah, they are not speaking about the stroke. They speak about maybe some personality changes because of the microemboli calcium going, this detective MRI. That's why maybe some changes, so are going to prevent it. But this can also occur during, I think, pre-dilatation. And now it's pre-dilatation is not allowed, except in specific situations. Exactly. Do you think that these cases, which she needs pre-dilatation, may need cerebral protection? Maybe.
Maybe. And there is data from the US that in patients with bicuspid valves, the risk of stroke is doubled. But maybe it's just because they do more frequently predilatation. I don't know.
I think the problem is that the data didn't differentiate between during the procedure and after 1 month. So when the procedure ended using cerebral protection, the patient may develop stroke after 4 or 5 days in the first month. Mm-hmm. And the percentage the same with cerebral protection. So I think, as you mentioned, we have to select the patient with carotid stenosis, with heavy calcification, to detect this patient needs really cerebral protection in heavy calcification, especially in case of bicuspid aortic valve or porcelain aorta.
Okay, thank you very much, Terry, because out of time, now going to Bernard Chevalier, thank you.